If you're a dentist struggling with back, neck, or shoulder issues, then this video is for you. Hi, I'm Dr. Siju Jacob. I've been a private practitioner in Bangalore and Dubai for the past 25 years. I've been using a surgical microscope in my private practice for more than 20 years, and I've been training dentists how to use a surgical microscope in everyday clinical practice for more than a decade. We dentists tend to complain about a lot of things, but if you were to ask me what's the single most common complaint that we hear from virtually every dentist that you see, it will be this. My back hurts, my neck is sore, my shoulder is sore, and so on. Physical injuries are something that virtually every single dentist experiences in their lifetime, and for some of them, it can almost end their career. Why do dentists tend to get physically injured? It is because of the nature of dentistry itself. Dentistry forces you to work in all kinds of awkward positions. If these positions are just for a few minutes, you tend to get away with it. But the problem with dentistry is that these few minutes are repeated time after time. They turn into hours, weeks, months, and eventually years. And it is this repetition over a long period of time that results in physical injuries. In this video, I want to break down the main reasons why dentists get injured and provide you solutions to prevent injuries. Before we talk about solutions, we need to understand the cause first. And to understand causes of injuries for dentists, we need to understand what kind of motions dentists use in everyday clinical practice and what we mean by neutral positioning. Let's look at these two. Let's start with motions. When dentists work in everyday clinical practice, they are usually in five types of motions, class 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. Let's look at what each of these motions mean. Let's start with class 1. When we say dentists are in class 1 motion, we mean only the fingers are moving. Class 1 means movement of the fingers. Class 2 is not just movement of the fingers, but movement of the wrists as well. So somebody passes an instrument, you receive it, and then you move your wrist. This is class 1 followed by class 2. That's movement from the wrist. Class 3 is movement from the elbow, which means you are moving your elbow. Your elbows are supported, so your shoulders aren't involved. It's just the elbows are rotated. So class 1, class 2, and then class 3. Class 4 is movement from the shoulders. So in this case, the elbows aren't supported anymore. So anytime you move your elbow, because it isn't supported, the shoulders come into play. So this is class 4 motion. Class 5 is movement from the torso. So you are rotating your hips to reach out for an instrument, for example. This is class 5. The chances of a dentist getting injured increases as one moves from class 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 upwards. So at class 1, you have absolutely no chances of getting injured. Class 2, class 3 are also pretty safe, but class 4 and 5, your chances of getting injured increases dramatically. So ideally, to minimize injuries, a dentist needs to aim to be in class 1, 2, and 3 motions most of the times and minimize the number of times when he or she is in class 4 or 5 motions. But if we were to put a camera and then capture a day in any dentist's work and see what kind of motions they employ the majority of the times, you will be surprised that almost 98-99% of dentists, when you review the footage of a typical day in a clinical practice, you will find that they are almost always in class 4 and 5 motions, which means most of them don't use an armrest. So by default, the elbows are not supported. So you are already in class 4 and 5 motions. And this, when you combine it with alterations in the neutrality of the spine, which we will talk about in the section that's coming up, a combination of these two is what results in injuries. So we talked about motions. Now let's look at what we mean by neutrality of the spine. So apart from making an attempt to doing most of your dentistry in class 1, 2, or 3 motions so that you remain ergonomics, the second factor that a dentist needs to consider is whether or not they are neutral in terms of your spine position. So the spine has a natural S-shaped curve, and you want to maintain that neutrality of the spine when you are performing everyday clinical dentistry. Now, most dentists tend to make one of the two mistakes. One is they tend to arch backwards. So they sit like this, and then they tend to arch backwards while working. This is one mistake. This is not that common because most dentists don't arch backwards. The most common mistake is they tend to do the opposite. They tend to arch forwards like this. So when they are working on a patient, they tend to arch forwards like this. When you do this, again, you are altering that natural curve of the spine by exerting a lot of pressure moving forwards. So when you do this, look at the amount of stress that is put on the lower back and your shoulders and your neck because you're arching forwards. And this happens because the natural neutrality of the spine gets altered. So if you keep these two factors in mind, that is, firstly, try and be in class one, two, or three motions, and then try and maintain the neutrality of the spine while performing dentistry, then you tend to be ergonomic most of the time. So let's just refresh this whole concept of being in the right posture. So you need to first adjust the height of the chair so that your thighs are parallel to the floor. So you keep adjusting it till you get into a position where the feet are resting firmly on the ground. And while they are resting firmly on the ground, the thighs are parallel to the floor. Step number one. And once that is done, you look at being in an absolutely neutral position. Position your legs in such a way, neither too wide nor too close, in such a way that you're absolutely neutral. Okay. And then we look at the spine itself. Is it straight? Is it arching forwards? Is it arching backwards? Look at those parameters and make sure that it's nice and neutral. Once you've got all these parameters, then we look at the elbows. You want to make sure the elbows are in a position where your forearms are parallel to the floor and your thighs. Your shoulders shouldn't be too high, because when you move your elbows too high, then the shoulders get raised up and there's a lot of stress on the shoulders and the neck. Neither do you want to be too low, because if it's too low, then your shoulders tend to hunch forwards like this. Okay, so you want to avoid those two extremes. You want to be absolutely neutral and the forearms are parallel to the thigh. Now, when you do this, if you don't have elbow support, then eventually that also will lead to stress on the shoulder. So you want to have a chair which has elbow support arms, which can be adjusted according to the operator. So you have a chair like this and you move the elbow support up and down and you get it down into a comfortable position so that your elbows can be nice and neutral and parallel to your thighs, and you end up working like this. This is pretty much how you get into an ergonomic position. So maintain neutrality of the spine, and then when you perform all actions, try and perform most of your actions in class one, two, or three motions by having an elbow and an armrest. So you reach out for an instrument, you take it, you use it, and then you put it back. All these motions can be done in class one, two, and three motions. And you avoid class four and five motions to very rare instances. Like, for example, you're taking an x-ray. Yes, so that time you move into class four and class five. But the majority of the time, say 95% of all your dentistry, if you perform your work ergonomically, you can do it in class one, two, and three motions, provided you have the right kind of magnification. So now we understand what we mean when we say performing your dentistry in a neutral position of your spine, as well as performing most of your dentistry in class one, two, or three motions so that you are ergonomic. What we need to avoid is class four and five motions. Now, despite knowing all these things, why is it that dentists are still forced to work in all kinds of awkward positions? The reason is the nature of dentistry itself. You are sitting upright and you are in a neutral position, and yes, you are trying to do most things in class one, two, or three motions, but the problem is your patient or the area that you're trying to work on is far away from you, and you just can't see the area that you're trying to work on. So to compensate and to see that area better, you tend to arch forward. This is what happens. So typically, the ergonomics are the worst when one isn't using any form of magnification. The minute one starts using some form of magnification, for example, loupes, then this tendency to arch forward gets reduced. So loupes are far better than naked eye, but they are not 100%. Why? Because the working distance is something that is kind of fixed with loupes. So you have to arch forwards a little bit to perform everyday clinical dentistry. The only tool that can help you work completely ergonomic in a very, very neutral position is the surgical microscope. The reason being that the microscope is fixed and it gives you a lot of flexibility and it forces you to learn mirror skills. You have amazing magnification and illumination, so the visibility is not a problem. And one learns mirror skills, and coupled with mirror skills, one can literally work on any area that you want in an absolutely ergonomic manner. And that's why we say the only tool that can help you perform clinical dentistry absolutely ergonomically is the surgical microscope. I hope what we spoke just now motivated you in some small way to start using the surgical microscope and work ergonomically. If you'd like to take the next step, then do check out my online course, Microscopic Dentistry Simplified, the links of which are coming up. I've covered everything you need to know to get started with microscopic dentistry in everyday general dentistry practice. If you would like to see more videos like this, then don't forget to click on that subscribe button so that you get notified every time I upload a new video. Don't forget to share it with your friends who you think might find it useful, and I'll see you next week with another video.